Hey guys, we need to do something. We need to make ourselves heard. By who? By NASA, of course. Why? Well, it's about Sedna, the great little world that has been moving in the Kuiper Belt at the edge of the solar system for billions of years. Sedna is a trans-Neptunian object known primarily for its high elliptical orbit, which takes a whopping 11,390 years to complete one trip around the Sun. Currently, Sedna is heading towards its perihelion, its closest point to the Sun, which it will reach in 2076 before heading back into the depths of space, not to return for millennia. This makes the upcoming flyby a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity to study an object from the far reaches of our solar system. Sedna is the first object we've ever found that might have originated from the Oort Cloud. If we really want to seize this opportunity, we need to get to work immediately and plan a mission that can launch within the next 20 years. NASA is considering it, but there's a risk that the decision might be negatively influenced by what psychologists call the old father syndrome, which in this case refers to the scientific community's inability to get excited about projects that would only see completion many years after the participants' lives or careers have ended. In short, NASA is crunching the numbers and will have to give an answer soon. But there's widespread fear that this enormous opportunity might ultimately be missed. Can we do something about it? Obviously not. These are decisions made above our heads, driven by economic reasons and only partly scientific ones. But maybe we can try to understand more about it, to start a debate whether we can make our opinion known. What do you say? Shall we give it a try? We are making so much progress in understanding the universe, studying galaxies billions and billions of light years away, yet we still know very little about the planetary system that hosts us. No one, in fact, can yet answer this simple question. Where does our solar system end? In the early 90s, our celestial cradle seemed to hold no more secrets for us Earthlings. The USA's Mariner probes and the USSR's Venera missions had unveiled the surface of Mercury, Venus, and Mars, while the Pioneer and Voyager missions had managed to reach and photograph the outer giant planets. Thus, with the ghosts chased in the past, like the planet Vulcan, sought between the Sun and Mercury but never found, and the 10th planet, thought to be beyond Pluto, long gone, it was almost believed that every corner of our cosmic cradle, from Mercury to Pluto, had already been explored. One star, 9 planets, many moons, thousands of asteroids, a few comets now and then. What else could there be to discover? Then in 1992, the surprise discovery of the first object in orbit beyond Pluto arrived, soon followed by many other medium-sized asteroids, 200 or 300 kilometers in diameter. The first true inhabitants of the Kuiper Belt, whose existence had only been hypothesized until then. And it was as if the solar system suddenly doubled in size. It was indeed true. Beyond Neptune's orbit extended a belt 10 times wider than the asteroid belt, with a huge number of rocky and icy objects orbiting the Sun at distances between 35 and 55 astronomical units, equivalent to hundreds of billions of kilometers, given that an astronomical unit measures about 150 million kilometers. But that was just the beginning. The digital revolution was allowing us to find increasingly faint objects. In November of 1998, Chaos was found, a trans-Neptunian object 600 kilometers in diameter and 46 astronomical units away. Then in November of 2000, it was Varuna's turn, 680 kilometers in diameter and 43 astronomical units away, followed in May of 2001 by Ixion, 700 kilometers in diameter and 40 AU away. Then came the team of Michael Brown, an astronomer at Caltech who had set up a revolutionary wide-field survey with the Oskin telescope at Palomar. And it was during that observational campaign that, on the night of November 14, 2003, an object was identified. And from here we switch to the present tense, as befits important historical events, to which the provisional designation 2003 VB12 was assigned. From the first available data, it was clear that we were dealing with something extremely distant. An initial analysis suggested it might be about 100 AU away, but not only that, Preliminary estimates indicated it was a really large object with a diameter that could approach 2,000 kilometers. The observations of November 14th were confirmed by other observatories, and thanks to subsequent observations, an initial possible orbit was hypothesized. But the available data was still too scarce to yield sufficiently acceptable results. To calculate the characteristics of an orbit, it is necessary to have observations covering a time span of several years. However, there is a workaround, namely pre-covery observations, short for pre-discovery recovery. The hope is that the object might have been photographed months or years earlier during some other survey, thus extending the observational arc as much as possible. And that's exactly what happened with 2003 VB12. The object was also identified in images from the Palomar quest taken in previous months. The new astrometric data not only allowed for a more accurate orbit to be defined, but also enabled the identification of the object in images taken by the Palomar-Schmidt telescope, dating back even to previous years. Before moving on, don't forget to subscribe to our channel if you haven't already. Make sure to hit the notification bell so you don't miss out on our daily videos. Now, with the available data, we can define its orbit with sufficient precision. It turns out that at the time of its discovery, the object was 90 AU from the Sun, but also that 2003 VB12 follows a very elongated elliptical orbit, with its perihelion, the closest point to the Sun, at 76 AU, and its aphelion, the farthest point, at a staggering 937 AU, or 140 billion kilometers. An incredibly large orbit, so much so that it takes the object a whopping 11,400 years to complete it. No other known object discovered beyond Neptune reaches such distances, and so suddenly the solar system found itself 10 times larger. Beyond the daunting numerical reality, this also means a bunch of other things, like the fact that sunlight takes about 130 hours, or almost 5.5 days, to reach Sedna when it's at its aphelion. And to a hypothetical inhabitant of that place, the Sun would appear as a mere pinpoint, barely illuminating the surface like a thin crescent moon would here on Earth. When the official discovery was announced in February of 2004, it caused a sensation and was interpreted by many as the start of a new gold rush, with the Kuiper Belt replacing the Klondike. There was a strong belief that very soon, large planets would be found in those regions. And right away, the new arrival was hailed by all media as the 10th planet of the solar system. Due to its isolation in those icy regions, the discoverers proposed that 2003 VP12 be named Sedna, after an Inuit deity. The indigenous people of the Arctic regions of North America and Siberia, believed to be the mistress of the deep sea and mother of all creatures that inhabit the ocean. But a question loomed. How could an object of planetary dimensions have such a strange orbit? Indeed, Sedna's celestial path is very different from that of objects populating the Kuiper Belt. It resembles more the orbit of a long-period comet, one of those icy bodies that reside even farther away in the so-called Oort Cloud, a spherical region of space surrounding our solar system and thought to be a reservoir of cometary objects. It is believed that the cometary nuclei populating those remote regions can sometimes be influenced by gravitational forces capable of diverting them towards the inner regions of the solar system. And this could be the case with Sedna, with the difference that this time we are facing an object with unimaginable dimensions for a comet. Moreover, it is impossible to think that Sedna's orbit is the original one. The high eccentricity is a clear sign of significant dynamic interventions. Not to mention that it would also be very difficult to explain how such a large amount of material could have aggregated at such a distance from the Sun. Without a doubt, Sedna must have formed elsewhere and then been placed in its current orbit by some powerful dynamic mechanism. For example, the passage of a star roughly the size of the Sun at a distance of about 800 AU in ancient times. According to simulations, such an event could not only have created such elongated orbits, but also explain the very origin of Sedna. This hypothesis led to an even more intriguing scenario. Other numerical simulations suggested that the perturbing star might not have come from outer space, but could have been one of the many stars formed with the Sun within a small star cluster. A fascinating hypothesis, but and obviously very difficult to prove with such little data available. However, it is not Sedna's strange orbit that thrusts it into the spotlight. It is its size that interests the general public. The images that led to its discovery did not allow for very precise diameter estimates. One had to rely on apparent brightness and distance, which were two known values. But then assumptions had to be made about the surface reflectivity. From a set of considerations, a diameter of 1,800 kilometers was estimated, so much so that, as we have already seen, it was immediately hailed as the 10th planet of the solar system. It was indeed the largest trans-Neptunian object after Pluto. And from there began that long, somewhat scientific and very political process that would lead to the discussion to demote Pluto from its planetary status. You all know how it went, right? Until the 1800s, there was no need to define a planet. The only inhabitants of the solar system were comets, satellites, and of course planets, those known since antiquity, to which Uranus and Neptune had been added. A demarcation so evident that there was no need to codify it in a definition. Common sense was more than enough. Then came the discovery of Ceres in 1801, followed shortly by that of numerous other objects confined between Mars and Jupiter. At first, Ceres was on the verge of acquiring the title of planet, but within a few years, the number of potential new planets, which we now know to be mere asteroids, began to grow alarmingly. And it was precisely their large number that excluded the possibility that those points of light could all be classified as planets. Two centuries later, the same thing happened in the Kuiper Belt. The discovery of Sedna, initially believed to be much larger than it actually was, and then that of Eris in January of 2005, led astronomers to fear that the skies would soon be invaded by dozens of planets. And so, instead of facing an embarrassing situation, it was more convenient to demote Pluto, giving it the consolation prize of dwarf planet status. Michael Brown himself in recent years has proposed that the existence of such distant planetoids with elongated orbits like Sedna could be the evidence of a perturbing planetary-sized body, the famous ninth planet, which has been talked about so much in recent years. So what do you think? Based on what we've told you so far, did Sedna deserve, or does it still deserve, all the attention we're giving it? If your answer is yes, then you'll be pleased to know that you're in full agreement with those planning a space mission to the planetoid. Sedna will reach its perihelion in the years 2075 to 2076. It will come to its closest distance from the Sun, 76 AU, and this event will be an opportunity that won't repeat for about 11,400 years. Reaching Sedna with a spacecraft will not be an easy task. For comparison, Neptune is about 30 AU away, and the Voyager missions launched in 1977 are currently at 165 and 138 astronomical units respectively. And just like the Voyagers, which used Jupiter's gravity to complete their tour of the solar system, similar gravitational slingshots will be needed to make the journey to Sedna manageable. A team of scientists led by Vladislav Zubko from the Space Research Institute of the Russian Academy of Sciences has recently studied a series of possible trajectories, favoring a 2029 launch date as the most feasible option. The 2029 trajectory would take the spacecraft first to Venus, then back to Earth, twice, before passing Jupiter on its way to Sedna, with a flight duration of 20 years and more likely 30. A 30-year flight plan would mean flying by Sedna more slowly, allowing more time to gather data on the object. Choosing this option would give the probe a relative speed of 13.70 kilometers per second at Sedna's flyby, comparable to the speed at which New Horizons approached Pluto in 2015. As a bonus, this trajectory would also take the probe past a 145-kilometer diameter asteroid called Massalia, providing the team with an additional scientific target to study, as well as the opportunity to test the probe systems. A second trajectory proposed by the team would involve a 2034 launch and a similar additional flyby, this time of the metallic asteroid 16 Psyche. At the moment, it is unclear whether a mission to Sedna will actually make it to the launch pad, with all the competing options available to mission planners in the next decade. But since this is clearly our only chance to solve a mystery that could be the key to moving from interplanetary to interstellar space, our hope is that NASA will be able to convince the US government to fund this mission, even if by the time it arrives around 2070, there will be almost no one left to take credit for its success. Guys, if you, like us, believe in the importance of this mission, talk about it. Stir up forums and social media, write to newspapers, and who knows, maybe the miracle will happen.